store in the undo stack. We store it to disk in some kind of log file. So at least when somebody does lose a graphic, we've got a record of their actions that
perform. Yeah. Yeah, that's. This is tricky. It's not certain. Okay, so we fixed like about five places where graphics go missing, and kind of different reasons. And one case is that like everything goes in and out of the document graphically fine, and it's only when you go to actually save it goes missing. So the log doesn't help there. So we need to identify.
Is the mic working?
Yeah,
it does. So the next presentation would be about inconsistencies recently fixed on master. I'm Miklos, Vajna, also working for Collabora. I guess a fairly large amount of you already know me. Just in case you don't know, I arrived as a Google Summer of Code student to this community years ago, and since then I'm mostly focusing on Writer. So in 4.2, a fix landed, which finally allows selecting the whole document text in case the document is starting with a table. And there was a bug report for that for quite some time back in the LibreOffice org bugzilla as well. And the behind the scenes reason for this is that in this particular case, the selection starts inside the table and it ends outside of it. And that's kind of an inconsistency. Either we have a table cursor and then we select a number of cells, like a part of a row, or a full row, or part of a column, or a full column. So something rectangular, that would be the table cursor. Or we have a normal cursor, but in that case, it should be a subset of a cell, or just a set of paragraphs. So it's nothing that would involve tables themselves. And so we had a request to finally remove this limitation, and it turns out that it wasn't that hard. So in the original bug report, some developers estimated that this would take, I don't know, half years of work to fix or something like this. And it turns out that the neat hack that's possible is that you don't actually need to select the whole table. It's enough if you select the text inside the table, and that will already do what you want. In this particular case, the reporter wanted to mark the whole document text, so he can adjust, or she can adjust the font or something like this, and or just increase the font size or something like this. And for this, you don't really have to select the table, you only need to select the text inside the table. And it turns out that actually, when we have something like this, then we also have a look at if maybe Word has a better solution for this. And they use a really similar trick. So they have a definition of what's a valid selection. That's necessary because in the file you can store what was the current selection when the document was saved. And to be able to do that, you have to define what's a valid selection. And they have the same limitation, and still you can just control A and have the whole document text selected. So finally, you can do the same in the Writer. The next thing is that if you review lots of legal text, then you will use redlining a lot, I mean change tracking. And if you So the redlining is not the favorite area of writer developers, I guess. It's completely independent from the undo redo handling. On the other hand, from a user's point of view, they are really similar. In most cases, you have a set of operations and you would like to record them, and possibly you would like to undo them or just forget about how did you get to some state, and you are just interested about the current state. So it's similar, but certainly the code for these are duplicated. So the current pain with the redlining was that in case you had a spelling error in a redline text, so somebody typed this in some new string, and that string contained a spelling error, then when you right-click to reject the spelling error, because it's an error, the spell check pop-up menu comes up, and you can't reject the change. So the solution for this is just to combine the two pop-up menus in case you are inside the change tracked text and still have a spelling error, then you can do both changes, like completely reject that insertion or just correct the spelling problem. The next thing is that in Writer we have all the drawing shapes that you can have in Calc or in Press or Draw, and that includes group shapes, and even the most of the Writer filters supports importing group shapes for the different file formats except RTF. So after you import group shapes, actually importing the real shapes are not a huge problem because that was there before. So with a not so major amount of work, you could actually have something working. The interesting thing here is that actually the group shape wasn't used here as the only solution for this. So, the creator of the document created a shape, put in some complex content, and instead of just duplicating the content during printing or using columns to have the content duplicated, he or she used the group shape to have this, have that. So that's how it turned out that once again, if the creator of the document would have a bit more practice about how to create same documents, then this wasn't being a problem. But anyway, no. I guess that's much better than what was there before. So this is really a kind of an inconsistency. Dot is the binary doc equivalent of so it is a template version of binary doc, and we could import those dot files for since probably the beginning, but you couldn't write them. And in the binary format, there is a single bit for controlling for in case this is a normal document or template, so it's not particularly hard. It's like, I don't know, it was something between 10 and 20 lines of code to implement the whole feature, so it wasn't complex, but nobody did it. And because of this, when you try to save your dot file, you couldn't save it back to the binary format because Writer detected that this is a filter type that only supported importing and not exporting. So it forced you into either exporting or saving as ODT or something. So you couldn't really not only save, but you couldn't even edit dot files. And it turned out that the fix wasn't that complex than it would expect it. So this is the end of the 4.2 section, and so far all the inconsistencies what I was talking about is something I fixed, or at least I was partly involved in that. But at the end of each section, I would also like to point out some favorite feature, which is not mine, but it would be a shame to exclude. So in the 4.2 section, my favorite inconsistency fix is borders around characters. Tamas is hiding somewhere. He's back at the stage. So he's the guy who actually finally implemented character borders. So you could have borders around table size, pages, paragraphs, but not characters. And this is especially problematic because this is possible even in HTML. So it loses formatting during HTML import. Also, all the board formats supported this, so it was just a pain to lose all that formatting. And now this is a fully fledged feature, so there is user interface for it, but not you would ever expect. So the next section is about the 4.3 fixes. And I guess this screenshot was already shown in some previous presentation. As maybe it was mentioned as a normal bug fix, but what's really interesting here is that there was some group shape here that was more or less a mess, and it started to make sense after fixing all the particular problems. But the interesting bit about this is that in OXML files, so this is the docx format for Writer, there are two competing markups to describe shapes. And of course, both of them have their own problems. The older one is the VML, and the newer one is the drawing ML. VML is the one-to-one equivalent to the binary format used to describe shapes. So the good thing is that we can always cheat from the binary filter when something is wrong in the VML or the other way around. So it's just yet another markup, but the concept is exactly the same. On the other hand, there is the drawing ML, that's a newer thing. Even the first Word version that already supported OXML didn't support drawing ML, so it's newer. The problem is that VML is only part of this OX, transitional OXML, so if you would like to go after OXML strict, then you can't use that. And the problem with drawing ML inside Writer is that it's not part of the specification at all. So it's some Microsoft specific extension something. And the problem and the reason for that is that drawing ML can only describe the shape itself, but not the positioning of the shape. That's a task for the container application. So in case of Writer, for example, the vertical position could be relative to a paragraph or a page, and a paragraph or a page or a column are concepts specific to Writer. So you can't squeeze down these settings into the drawing ML markup. But on the other hand, because initially Word didn't support drawing ML at all, they also left out the markup from the original word processing ML. So it's not yet in word processing ML, it's already not in drawing ML, and then you had to invent some new markup. The funny thing is that this wasn't specified till they tried to implement their own standard and finding out that using the existing markup is not possible to describe this feature. So the end of the story is that a significant improvement to the OXML shape filter for Writer documents was when we switched to reading drawing ML markup and only reading the VML fallback in case that's the only version there. And the reason for this significant improvement is that drawing ML was already used for quite some time for Calc documents and Impress ones. I guess Impress is the main driver here. And we could just hook the existing much improved drawing ML import into Writer, and with that a much improved end result appears on the screen. For example, this includes adjustments on shapes. So, like you have a triangle, and it's not a symmetric one, but has a custom custom geometry, like shifting the one corner in the right or left direction, for example. That's a shape adjustment. And still, and the VML importer still doesn't handle that properly. But for the drawing demo case, it was already working. So just by switching to the drawing demo one and hooking writer up with the drawing demo filter introduced all these improvements. The next one is that you could already have comments in Writer for quite some time. Then a few years ago, I implemented support for attaching comments to text ranges, so not just a single position. And then this got reworked to also support nesting these comments. This is not something I ever thought about, and nobody complained about this for quite some time. So it wasn't a pending known issue, but it turned out that we failed quite badly if you try to start one command, then start another, and then you end first, and then end the other. And what's probably interesting here is that we not only, so this got fixed in core, but not only that got fixed, also I went through all the major writer filters and made sure that both the import and the export of that is working with these nested commands. There is still one remaining detail in the binary doc importer. In case we have some non-trivial content in the commands, then that may still cause problems. And the idea there is that these random text ranges are working properly for bookmarks. So basically, it would be a matter of debugging how bookmarks can even contain a whole table or something like this, and do the same range mapping for commands. And then we would be really 100% perfect. So the next thing is relative sized text frames. The interesting feature is that it's possible to have a 100% width for a text frame, but exactly what 100 means isn't really specified. And it turned out that the specification and the writer implementation, luckily they are in sync, they mentioned that the current paragraph area is the 100%. So in case you are inside the table cell, then 100 means the width of the table cell. But in case you have columns, then the 100% will be the width of the column itself. Or if you just have plain text, then it will be the paragraph frame. So it will be the page size, excluding the margins, so it can mean different things. And this is all quite implicit. If you would like to have something fixed, like setting it to some relative size of something fixed, then one possibility, and what was requested, is to be able to have the size relative as part of a page. So now there is one more combo box on this text frame properties dialog, and you can choose if the relative size should be relative to the paragraph area or the entire page. And it's a combo box because more options could be also possible there, but for now these two are supported. One more inconsistency on import, we typically give some feedback to the user where we are with the import process, but this was missing for docx. And it turns out that the docx document can contain the number of paragraphs as a metadata, so we could read that and before doing the real import, except that we didn't write that metadata either. So the task was fixing first the metadata exporter to contain the number of paragraphs, and once it was there, or it was produced by Word or some other software, then implement the OSI of the progress bar. So this is now working. If you would like to test this feature, and you would need some larger document with not just pictures so that the document is trivially large, but lots of contents, then for example, the Holy Bible is a really good test document for stressing the progress bar implementation, so I can recommend that. I can recommend it anyway, but for progress bar import testing, it also makes sense. Another thing is support for OXML is a constant topic, but strict OXML is a newer one. It's something that the newest Microsoft Office supports to some extent, and we completely refuse to open those documents because the XML namespaces are completely different. And Marcus did quite some fixing regarding that for Calc and Impress. Where are you, Marcus? Where are you hiding? He's not here. So he escaped, but the major part of the work was done by him. And I did the docx part of that. So during import, now we support the ACMA version, the OXML transitional, and the OXML strict. And not counting over the various Microsoft extensions, which are also implemented in Word, so we are required also support. On the export side, strict is not supported yet. It could be implemented, but it would be some reasonable amount of work, and as long as we don't really have a use case just to have it, it's not that important than dealing with other more real-life specific issues. One more inconsistency in the OXML filter is about pattern fields. Not sure if you can see this, but this is not a solid color, it's kind of a pattern with lots of vertical lines. And there are quite some predefined patterns in the OXML standard. And of course we have our internal model, how do we represent these patterns. So on import we try to do some kind of mapping to our document model so that the end result will look similar to the original reference output. And it turns out that of course this is not a perfect mapping, but as long as the output is similar enough, then we can be happy. Except that in case on the export side we don't have the exact same rules for mapping. So when you export back, then the same predefined pattern won't get written to the document. So it was a matter of finding exactly where the importer has these rules for this particular predefined pattern and making the exporter doing exactly the reverse of the import one. And then the predefined pattern didn't last. And my favorite in this section is the long writer paragraphs. This was a limitation of the OS string class, and in the binary doc filter, I guess we still have this kind of horrible code trying to split up paragraphs into smaller chunks so that writer can handle it. In practice, I guess this is mostly interesting in case you are copy-pasting some content from some web page where the line break is used for each new paragraph and not a real paragraph markup. And for these paragraphs, we are also just importing new lines and not new paragraphs in Writer. So in this way, it's easy to end up with such long paragraphs. And finally, this limitation is gone. So the next section is about the not yet released version, and I spent quite some time on adding writer-specific text boxes to shapes. That means that you can have a shape with a custom geometry, like rounded edges, or it can be a rectangle, a triangle, or anything like that. And regarding the text of the shape. Up to you now, you could only use this edit engine based text content, which doesn't support other writer specific features like tables or writer fields or embedded objects like charts or anything more complex. And but I can. So this was on import type. You had time. You had to choose if you would like to get your geometry and simple content or complex content. But then you use the custom geometry. And now it's possible to right-click on a shape on Writer, in Writer, add the text box. And text box is exactly the same as the text of the shape, except that the text box has the document model of the normal Writer content. So you can have both complex content and custom geometry at the same time. And I guess I still have a few more minutes. So I would like to mention a few filter fixes I have done recently. We do quite some of these regularly, so it's possible that when it's release time, we already forgot what the fix was. There was no blog entry about that, and then so on. But on the other hand, these are usually variable, so at least now I try to remember what I was fixing in the past few weeks and mention what's possibly interesting. So in Writer, for Writer pictures, you can have a custom wrap polygon for a picture. So this is the whole picture frame in Writer. And still, if you have some stripped down Twitter logo, then you can have a custom polygon. And the wrapping will be performed based on this and not based on the full picture frame. And this was imported from Docx, but it wasn't exported. And I guess the number one reason was that it's on the import side. No, so the wrap polygon description depends on the drawing amount marker. So as long as we didn't fix this VMR or the drawing amount, and it wasn't possible to easily export this. As I mentioned, that was done now quite some time ago, so it was possible to finally implement this. So now if you save back a custom wrap polygon to Docx, then that's preserved properly. Another long requested feature was about the RTF filter in case you had some anchor pictures, like not anchored as a character, but anchored to paragraph, to character, to page, something like that. Then during saving, all the pictures became inline. And the reason for that is that the RTF standard doesn't support this. And later, from the RTF point of view, you can have a picture that's always inline, or you can have a shape, like a triangle with a blue background color, and that can be anchored properly. But you can't have the both at the same time. And the hack that was implemented in Vorn is that you can described such a picture as a shape having a bitmap background, and then you can have both at the same time. And this hack wasn't implemented in our RTF filter, but on master this is now fixed. I'm going backwards. Okay. The last thing is that, or maybe it's not the last. Anyway, I guess it's quite rare that I touch Impress code. It turned out that it was a one-liner patch to also import OXML metadata from PPTX. And for Calc and Writer, we did that for quite some time, but for Impress, all these created and modified dates, and now here I removed the names, but the names would be also here, full of zeros, and now this is properly implemented. And the functionality was really just there, but a missing method call prevented this from actually working. And the last filter fix I would like to mention here is about the Writer HTML export. People like to use LibreOffice as a conversion machine, and part of that is when random Writer documents are saved as HTML, and then random search engines can easily search the content. And the problem is that when you have some embedded object inside the document, that's typically written out as a picture. know if you already optimized your usage of LibreOffice as a conversion engine, then if you are really just interested in the textural output, then probably you already enabled the option to completely skip images. That's why the embedded objects are completely lost. But actually, in case it's an embedded document or an embedded spreadsheet, then we have an idea how to represent the embedded object as HTML, because we have an HTML exporter in Calc. So what we currently do is that if you skip images, then we write the HTML markup for the embedded object, and now you can select also the part of the embedded object. So in this case, this is a table, and this is some text around that, and this is a Calc object actually. So you can do this partial selection, you can search in it and whatnot. And I guess I'm out of my time, so thanks for listening, and in case you have any questions, then I can try to answer. Or okay, so no nasty questions. Thank you for listening.